Hello and welcome to week four, day two. Two, it's two, Bill. Week four, day two of How to Write Your Novel in 9 weeks. I'm Little Willie Sockspear, and my assistant is Bill Dodds.
Your assistant?
Yes, you notice I promoted you? You did a lovely job yesterday, so I'm not increasing your salary, but I'm giving you a nicer title. Today, moving on, Bill, we're going to talk about the myth of the suffering writer.
The what?
The myth of the suffering writer.
Myth?
Right, myth. You know, the classic myths, Greek myths, Roman myths.
You mean myth?
Right, myth. The myths of the suffering writer.
All right.
Reviewing what the two of us have already written and said, I think Bill and I have tended to focus on how hard writing can be. Abandon hope, all ye who enter here. What if this isn't as hard as you thought it was going to be? What if you aren't suffering for your art? Well, then you're doing it wrong.
Willie.
Oh, they know I'm just kidding. I'm just joshing them. They know that. If things are going well, then stick with it, eh? If it works, don't go mucking it up.
The idea that a writer or anyone has to suffer to really produce is a cartload of hokum.
Is it what?
I said a cartload of hokum.
Oh, you put a lot of thought into that one, didn't you?
Too much?
It's a bit over, I gotta tell you. You know, cartload and hokum.
It's a romantic myth. That's not to say some writers haven't had incredibly hard lives, and they've used that experience, those experiences, to pen some touching and insightful works. Writers write what they know, right?
On the other hand, some accountants have had tough lives, and they too may be better at their vocation because of it. More diligently making sure another family doesn't squander its money end up... I can't do this. I can't do this sentence, Bill. Something's wrong. I can do this. I'm going to concentrate.
Good, you concentrate.
Well, you know, it's not easy when you're a sock.
All right. You can do this.
More diligently,
got that one,
making sure another family doesn't squander its money and end up in the poorhouse, for example.
There you go.
Right, I did it. And so too some teachers, some rabbis, some members of just about any profession or vocation you can think of.
You can be a tremendous novelist even if you're happily married, have great kids, and enjoy your day job. Even if you only drink socially or not at all, have never inhaled and shun caffeine and tobacco.
Well, you could, couldn't you? You don't need that. That's a point. In the same way, you can write a great book without having that cabin by the lake. Your holy of holies, your retreat, your sanctuary in which to write it.
Yeah, we assume they're not at the lake right now. The person working on the 9-week novel isn't at the lake, at their cabin.
Not looking out the huge picture window to gaze out on a vast expanse of lake and forest and... No, wait. French doors. Look out those French doors open just a few inches so you can feel the breeze taking the pine-scented fresh air. Listen to the...
Blah, blah, blah. If you did own that perfect cabin, you'd have to worry about taxes and insurance and a leaky roof and... Does that cabin have indoor plumbing?
Oh! Don't get me started on what it's like without indoor plumbing.
No, none of us wants to get you started on that.
The point is, you don't have to suffer to write a great novel. It is hard work, but you know that. And if it isn't so hard right now, good for you. Now get busy and write today's word count.
Tomorrow, I'm going to be talking about how much research is too much research.